Jewel Storm. Jewel Storm is a professor currently teaching and conducting research at the University of Amsterdam in literary and cultural analysis. Her research focuses on critical theories of the body. Originally trained in philosophy and women's studies, she extended her fields of interest to theories of art and aesthetics, queer theory, post-human theories, phenomenology, and more recently, critical disability studies and medical humanities. Her research attempts to make bodily difference understandable, not only as negative, but as affirmative for all bodies. Her goal is to explore new methodologies in the humanities to account for the still unknown, but impending future of human and non-human bodies.
Hi, does this work? I'm always very intimidated by microphones, but I hope maybe I do this. All right. Thank you to the organizers to invite me to this exciting event. And I hope my talk will make some sense after all the great things that we've already heard today. But I will just tell you a little bit what I'm planning to do. And I'm not quite sure about the timing because I haven't practiced, but I think I will be within the half hour. What I will be doing is that I will be presenting a few ideas from my book, which was also, I think, the idea of the invitation here today, which is called Bodies We Feel. And it is about reading art, or reading visual art mainly, also reading literature in some sense, and an exploration of a new way of thinking and perceiving bodies. All right, so what I want to do today is to explore and maybe expand what Judy Rodul refers to as reality-producing entities. In my work on theories of the body, I'm especially interested in these entities and how they produce perceptions of bodies rather than perceptions of other things. My thesis is that not only cultural techniques produce these perceptions, but that specific perceptions themselves produce our bodies. What I mean is that I see perception itself, or acts like seeing, reading, touching, as cultural techniques, which are influenced by the symbolic value of material entities and other tools to make sense of the body. These perceptions as techniques are often unnoticeable because they have become part of our own embodiment. So we don't recognize them anymore as techniques because they are part of our what we are in our bodies. Therefore, I look at artworks which allow me to reveal these perceptions as trained cultural practices. Practices which could be undone or retrained or made strange. I will thus take Judy Rodul's proposition one step further, but then only in theory and not in art. So this is just a theoretical exploration, and argue that the way we perceive the world is a technique in itself, mainly structured by cultural stereotypes and beliefs about the body. The body then also becomes the place at which I hope to reveal these techniques as transformable practices. So not only that we are defined by those practices, but that they are also transformable. Frames and techniques that we use for perceiving the world are often structured by and reproduce mainstream beliefs or normative cultural perceptions, especially when they are used to look at bodies. How so? Material objects, such as window frames, cameras, books, etc., are often treated as lifeless objects. Even though they are produced by and for humans, they are assigned to the world of non-human things. However, since they are used as so-called lenses through which the human eye looks at something, They are important factors in the production of the perceived object. The human body is a special object in that respect. It is an object and a subject alike. It is alive, it moves, it has a will, it changes through time, it responds to circumstances like climate or food and other bodies, etc. And it perceives. It is thus an object and a subject which poses a challenge to perception. One could say that cultural tendencies to categorize bodies, for example, into gender norms, relate to this difficulty. They are an attempt to fit the body into objective frames. Therefore, specific frames and other tools through which bodies have historically been looked at should be reflected about with suspicion. If one believes, like I do, that bodies should not be categorized objectively. One example is the invention, for example, of medical photography in the early 20th century. This is just one of a lot of images like these. So in medical photography, portraits or mugshots of so-called aberrant subjects were presented always in a series of similar frames and sizes. Comparison through the artificial uniformity of the picture frame necessarily led to the spotting of deviances from a constructed norm. The goal of this medical or statistical practice was, of course, to locate the site of deviance on the body of these social outcasts instead of in the eye of the beholder or in the framework of statistics or a certain type of politics. Another aim was to inform the public of codes of insanity, disability, and other so-called aberrations from racial and sexual norms. The effect of this practice was that the public was taught how to look at bodies through specific frames of perception. But the problem was that these frames of perception became quickly naturalized, or you could say invisible, as if they have not determined our ways of seeing. So the frames through which bodies were looked at were determining what could be seen or what can be seen, but at the same time the frame became invisible, so we forgot that we can only see what we see by having been taught to see the way we see. Our cultural history of picturing bodies as deviant, for example in medical photography, schooled our ways of seeing bodies through the idea of comparison to the grid or the standard norm. I want to stress here that it is not per se the combination of photography or other forms of visual technology and the invention of statistics that created the basis for visually differentiating between the norm and that which is perceived as abnormal, but that these techniques in fact influenced perception itself. So it's not only that difference was created through specific cultural practices or medical practices, but that these practices in fact influenced how we can see. My approach in theory is to examine ways of countering these cultural practices of looking, especially at bodies or at bodily difference. I aim not to look at difference through the idea of the normal body, but through the idea of a normed vision at the body. I want to recognize cultural practices of seeing, which includes not only techniques, objects, or frames through which we look at the world, but it includes, more importantly, the bodies with which we look. I take the double role of the body as object-subject as a key element in my exploration. And I want to recognize bodies as perceived and as perceiving. The body in my theory becomes part of the frame, you could say, through which we look at other bodies and ourselves. In artistic projects by artists like genderqueer photographer Della Grace Vulcano, the medical frame is being put to the fore and subverted. I'm going to show you a few pictures, which I say that I'm reading them, but in the limited amount of time that I have here, I'm not really reading them, so I just give you the short link of my previous reading, which took much longer, which is part of my argument that the reading is important because it takes time. So in artistic projects like this by Della Grace Vulcano, the self-portraits here cite and mock pathological imaging. Vulcano conjures a medical image series that fails to work because the subjects look back at the viewer. So they are not presented here as passive, even though they cite the frames of medical imaging, but they look back at the viewer. The series consists of the same subject in different looks, which also makes the so-called spotting the difference a ridiculous act. The viewer's tendency of comparing bodies is revealed as belonging to the looking subject rather than to the perceived bodies. So difference here becomes something that lies within the viewer rather than within the depicted subject. I'm going to focus on one of the images of this series. The eyes of depicted subject here are the only colored element in the image. I don't know if you can see them, but they're blue. They're quite dark blue, actually. So the rest of the image is black and white, except for the eyes, which makes them seem more alive, more active than the rest of the image. The artificiality of the image heightens the sense that classificatory imaging is always an act of artificial categorization that relates more to the practice of seeing than to the body's inherent difference. The ambiguity of the pictured subject in terms of gender, for example, but also you could argue age and skin color, because we don't really know if the subject is white, but it's just white lighting. The ambiguity of the pictured subject creates a void in the viewer's perception. The symbolic meaning of the pictured body fails and returns the viewer to him or herself. The life of the portrait here lies in the subject's look. The face itself remains unresponsive, mirroring the deadening effects of visual objectification, such as in medical photography. This is also, of course, a self-portrait, which in itself makes a difference to the tradition it cites, which is, of course, not self-portraiture, but portraiture. So the self-portrait here counters the representational truth of the photographic portrait in general. Vulcano does not so much queer gender here, or you could also say queer race or age, but the artist queers what I want to call the visual practice of normative gender perception. So what happens here is that not the gender per se is presented as being different, but there's a form of communication between the viewer and the subject as it is presented, and trying to do something to perception itself and to make perception aware of its normative action. I want to just quickly show a picture in contrast, maybe to make this point more clearly, by Lauren Rex Cameron, which is a trans activist photographer and artist, who made this self-portraiture. I want to say that the Cameron here precisely fails to reveal the frame of looking as the perception-producing element in looking at bodies. His hyper-masculine posing, despite the missing penis and the addition of the syringe, which is again a quotation to the medical practice, blinds us to the fact that we are looking at the image through comparison with the norm. So what we see is still a masculine body, which we will compare no matter what to any kind of images that we have about men or women. In this image, different viewers might see different things, but they won't be confronted with their own look. So despite the fact that this image does a lot, also especially, for example, maybe in trans activist circles, it doesn't do what I see the other images doing, which is to reveal the way we look at bodies. What I do with these images is that I read them instead of just looking at them. The act of reading is more processual, time-related, embedded in an existing narrative, yet capable of producing imaginative and alternative versions of the same story. What I find productive about the notion of reading bodies is the interaction of practices usually separated in everyday habits. Reading is not often linked to the realm of the visual, which is still the main sense through which bodies are categorized in culture. I question the visual practice of categorizing bodies not by understanding bodies differently, but by revealing the mechanisms of our visions of bodies. By reading artistic images of bodies in ways that add new or unseen dimensions to the image, or strange dimensions to the image, I aim to show that it is not the so-called deviant bodies that pose a problem to categorization, but it is the practices through which we look at them that is problematic, especially for the marginalization of the so-called abnormal body. Through the act of reading an image, I hope to reveal that it is not the content of the image that challenges our categorizations of bodies as much as it is the invitation by the image to read images differently. The invitation to retrain our viewing of bodies by challenging our practices of seeing. So when you compare this image to the one before, I would say that the content is clearly critical, if you can see it, but it is not the kind of invitation that I was looking for, to read the image differently. Now, what I want to do now is to refer a little bit to mirrors, as we have already heard a few references to mirrors, and they are very important in my work. So let's see what I can add to the discussion of the exhibition through my theoretical interpretation. So I want to read the images that I'm going to show you in a bit through what I want to call the concept of the mirror. And we've heard the word concept before. And I just want to stress that what I'm referring to when I use the mirror, I'm not referring to just the physical object of the mirror and its consistence and how it looks like and its size and its weight and its touch, etc. But I'm indicating more that the image has a cultural history, a historical specificity, and it has acquired meaning not only through the culture using or referring to it, but through the related practices that are always linked to the mirror. And I also want to stress that it is not an object with fixed meaning or value, because that can change over time and through location. The mirror in my work is treated as a material conceptual object that contains the promise to transform its meaning-producing effects. So even though I'm also referring to Lacan in my own work, I'm also trying to support those theories because I'm very critical of precisely their historical and cultural specificity and gendered specificity. Because I think there's something more to the mirror than some psychoanalytic theory has thought there is. So a mirror is never just an object, it is also always a cultural technique that relates to and inspires specific cultural practices of perceiving bodies through it. The mirror has enjoyed a special role in Western culture from the myth of Narcissus to, as I just said, psychoanalytic theories of, for example, the mirror stage, which is that formation of the self in a particular period of the infant. What is specific about these cultural narratives of the mirror is that they create a specific notion of the formation of a subject through self-reflection. The reflective object becomes a tool for identification. This self-reflection is seen as either necessary for the formation of an identity, as in psychoanalytic accounts. So the mirror stage is formational for the subject to come into being in society. Or it is doomed to produce excessive self-love and the threat of drowning in one's own image, as in the myth of Narcissus. All versions are problematic since they assume a seeming autonomy or natural strength of the mirror, as if it were almost naturally reflective of a subject and free of cultural meaning. It is almost as if the mirror itself were able to conjure all the transformations in the reflected subject or body. However, what I want to show with the help of a few images is that the mirror is in fact a tool for visualizing bodies according to specific cultural norms and expectations. And through the mirror, these norms become internalized in such a way that they become invisible. As I mentioned before about the cultural practices of perception, is that even though we've learned to see through frames, we don't recognize the frames anymore as determining the ways we see, which is the same with the mirror. The images I'm analyzing here counter the mirror's autonomy or agency, if you want. I want to start with this image by Anthony Crossfield, who's a British digital photographer. And the image is called Narcissus, and of course refers to the myth of Narcissus, who falls in love with his self-reflection and then perishes to die because he drowns in his own image. The Narcissus that we see here is doubled, aged, and removed from nature, so therefore it's a very contemporary definition of Narcissus. The image narrates the story of self-recognition differently here. It shows that looking in the mirror is a culturally defined practice that produces body image and bodily norms in specific ways. Self-recognition in Crossfield's image is dependent on seeing oneself and others with the other. So instead of showing just one subject, it shows two, almost two subjects. So one, not quite one, but more than one subject looking into the mirror together. So they're seeing with one another. The mirror here does not serve to convey a sense of wholeness in the mirrored subject, but presents self-recognition as always a shared and fragmented process, which is never quite complete or completed, which reminds me of the discussion of the mirror room upstairs, where we can also always see just fragments of ourselves and others. Through the digitally constructed nature of the photograph, the depicted bodies are fictionalized. The fictional version of the body here allows us to identify the common look at bodies as always dependent on existing stories and visions of bodies. Through Crossfield's image, we can learn to recognize the existence of alternative stories or visions. So by the recognition that self-identification through the mirror is just one story, we can, of course, be open to recognize other versions of that story. In Crossfield's work, we can see a redefinition of the function of the mirror as technique or self-recognition and body image. So in other words, he also uses the mirror in different ways, and I think there we can have a lot of interpretations about this image, but here clearly the image becomes something that is not only a self-reflecting tool, but also an actual material object that that is being countered by these two subjects. His images make us aware that our seeing of bodies is always a seeing through the value of the mirror. Seeing is here revealed as a cultural technique dependent on objects infused with cultural meaning. I want to continue now with two other visual objects. One is a sculpture by Robert Gober that probably all of you know, and he offers to my theory a different version of the mirror and a rethinking of its importance. So in Robert Gober's sculpture, he molds two separate corporeal shapes within a single body. The sculpture emphasizes the vertical symmetry of human bodies, not by replicating the symmetry, but by refusing the supposed reflection or likeness of the body's right and left sides. It also critically reflects on the supposedly fixed self-identification with one sex or gender. So when we think of the mirror as being formational of the gendered self, which is Lacanian theory, then this is an approach to a mirror symmetry that might not be as easy to define in terms of gender, and definitely not fixed. This sculpture robs the mirror of its function as counterpart for subject formation, and it allows a new definition of the body image. Also, what I find interesting about this work is that is its material, which you can maybe not see in the image. It's made of wax, and so it's therefore not only soft to touch, even though I have never touched it myself, but I can imagine touching it. And also, it changes over time, so it's one of those art objects that that transform by itself. So it's clearly a kind of mirror that is not like the mirror that we usually expect to encounter. This body consists of more than one, yet not quite two subjects who share one body. The sculpture is two bodies folded into one, mirroring its parts with a difference. Another photograph that I want to show is John Copland's self-portrait that has a subtitle called Back with Arms Above. This self-portrait reminds us of a mirror in the flesh, showing us its reverse side. It complicates the mirror's seeming transparency and makes us aware of the material quality of the mirror because it's a mirror in flesh and not a reflective mirror. Sorry. I'm not sure I'm doing this right. The picture and the title suggest that the artist's self is inexpressible in a picture or in a mirrored image. The image might here not be representative of the subject's self and therefore does not reflect the subject, but the impossibility of representing a subject in an image. The mirror represented by the photographer's back is blind in the process of aging yet alive. So it is blind because it doesn't actually reflect in terms of visual perception. And it's clearly an aging body, which means that it transforms materially, but it is still alive. Its gendered markers might be visible, but they're meaningless because they do not produce identification. The two fists pointing to the viewer seem to say, "Return your gaze to yourself. I will not serve as your mirror." The portrait subject looks into his own body for identification and creates the idea of a mirror within. Okay, I'm almost done. The goal of my reading of these images is to break the mirror's spell, if you want, in order to reveal the mirror's function as a prosthesis for our vision of bodies. With my analysis, I aim to expand the mirror's scope and potentially transmit its promises or effects to other objects and embodied subjects. The presented artworks provoke a rupture in the effective charm of the mirror by pointing at its rough edges, its blind spots, its potential failures to reflect every subject's sense of self. To be suspicious of the mirror's seemingly neutral function to reflect ourselves might be a way to make room for alternative ways of looking through, with, and without the mirror, and to develop alternative views of othered bodies. In my work, I am reading bodies through difference instead of through the norm. However, I refer to difference not in order to reveal something about these othered bodies, but about the practices or mechanisms, objects or tools which create difference as a negative value in perception. In this way, the mirror can be used as a concept to reveal the normative nature of our vision and as a tool to subvert these by proposing different uses and relationships to the mirror. In conclusion, I want to propose to understand our perception of bodies as cultural techniques or practices which could be practiced differently and therefore have different body-producing effects. Thank you very much.